In this video, mechanism of action of heparin will be discussed. Before proceeding further, let's discuss about the coagulation pathway, for the better understanding of the mechanism of action of heparin. There are two types of coagulation pathways. One is intrinsic pathway, which is activated by the exposed endothelial collagen after an internal damage to the vessel wall. Another is the extrinsic pathway, which is activated via the subendothelial tissue factor after external trauma, which causes blood to escape the circulation. Though these are two separate pathways, they merge at a point to form the common pathway. The common pathway finally activates fibrinogen into fibrin. These fibrins forms fibrin strands that bind the platelet plug and stabilizes it. It should be noted that the formation of platelet plug is the primary hemostasis mechanism and the two coagulation pathways are the secondary hemostasis mechanism. Please watch the platelet plug formation video for better understanding. The link of the video is given in the description. Let's now concentrate on the secondary hemostasis mechanism. First, we will discuss on the longer intrinsic pathway. When endothelial damage occurs, factor 12 is exposed to vascular endothelial collagen. This activates factor 12 to factor 12A. The activated factor 12 then activates factor 11 to factor 11A. The activated factor 11, along with calcium ion, activates factor 9 to factor 9A. Then factor 9A, along with factor 8A, phospholipid, and calcium forms a complex. This complex in turn activates factor 10 to factor 10A. It should be noted that factor 8 is activated by the factor 2A, that is thrombin. The intrinsic pathway is clinically measured as the partial thromboplastin time. Let's now concentrate on the shorter extrinsic pathway. When external injury occurs, the tissue factor, that is factor 3, is released. The factor 7 and tissue factor form a complex called TF7. Once factor 7 is bound to its cofactor, that is tissue factor, it gets activated by various proteases to form TF7A complex. Vitamin K is required for the activation of factor 7. This complex in turn activates factor 10 to factor 10A. This is the point where both extrinsic and intrinsic pathways merge into the common pathway. The extrinsic pathway is clinically measured as the prothrombin time. The common pathway begins when factor 10 is activated to factor 10A. Once factor 10A is formed, it binds with factor 5A and calcium to form a prothrombinase complex. This prothrombinase complex then activates prothrombin to thrombin. In other words, it activates factor 2 to factor 2A. One molecule of factor 10A can catalyze the formation of 1,000 thrombin molecules. It should be noted that factor 5 is activated by the factor 2A, that is thrombin. Then thrombin cleaves soluble fibrinogen, that is factor 1, into insoluble fibrin subunits. The fibrin subunits combine to form fibrin strands. Thrombin also cleaves factor 13, that is fibrin stabilizing factor, to factor 13A. The factor 13A cross-links the fibrin strands to form fibrin mesh. This mesh stabilizes the platelet plug, formed during primary hemostasis. Thrombin also activates factor 5, factor 8, and the platelets. This sequential activation of coagulation factors is called coagulation cascade. There are several negative feedback mechanisms to prevent overcoagulation. First is tissue plasminogen activator, secreted by the endothelial cells. It activates plasminogen to plasmin. The plasmin acts directly on fibrin mesh and breaks it down. Thus, it lyses the clot. Second is antithrombin 3, which produced in liver, inactivates mainly the factor 10A and thrombin. Thus inhibits the coagulation pathway. Antithrombin also inactivates factor 9A to a lesser extent. Third negative feedback mechanism is by protein C along with the cofactor protein S. The activated protein C along with protein S inhibits factor 5A and factor 8A, thus inhibits the coagulation. Protein C and S are mainly secreted in liver, and they are vitamin K dependent. Now, let's move to mechanism of action of heparin. Heparin is a sulfated polysaccharide with a molecular weight range of 3,000 to 30,000 Dalton. Low molecular weight heparin are fragments of unfractionated heparin, produced by enzymatic or chemical depolymerization. The low molecular weight heparin has mean molecular weight of about 5,000 Dalton. Heparin have unique pentasaccharide sequence that is randomly distributed along the heparin chains. Heparin inhibits factor 10A and 2A, that is thrombin via antithrombin 3. Let's see this in detail. Antithrombin 3 specifically binds to the pentasaccharide sequence of heparin. This binding activates the antithrombin 3. This activated antithrombin inhibits activated factor 10 and thrombin. It should be noted that the rate of inactivation of factor 10A and thrombin by antithrombin is accelerated by 1,000 times in the presence of heparin. There is a difference between the inactivation of the factor 10A and thrombin by heparin. Let's see in what way it is different. For inhibition of thrombin, that is factor 2A, heparin should bind both to antithrombin 3 and thrombin to form a ternary complex causing inactivation of thrombin. This ternary complex can be formed only by heparin having at least 18 saccharide units. But to inhibit factor 10A, heparin binding to factor 10A is not required. That is, only binding of antithrombin 3 to heparin pentasaccharide sequence is required to inhibit factor 10A. This difference in the mechanism of inhibition forms the basis of difference between unfractionated heparin and low molecular weight heparin. Most of unfractionated heparin has more than 18 saccharide units. So, it inhibits thrombin by forming ternary complex and also inhibits factor 10A in equal ratio. That is, unfractionated heparin has anti-factor 10A to anti-factor 2A ratio of 1 is to 1. Whereas, less than 50% of low molecular weight heparins has at least 18 saccharide units. So, low molecular weight heparin has greater inhibitory activity on factor 10A when compared to thrombin. That is, low molecular weight heparin have anti-factor 10A to anti-factor 2A ratios between 2 is to 1 and 4 is to 1, depending on the length of the saccharide units. It should be noted that by inhibiting thrombin, heparin not only prevents fibrin formation, but also inhibits thrombin-mediated activation of platelets and of factors 5 and 8. Fondaparinux is a synthetic pentasaccharide. It has only the pentasaccharide sequence to bind antithrombin 3, and thus it inhibits only the factor 10A. It doesn't inhibit thrombin, as it has no extra saccharide units to form ternary complex with thrombin. This completes the mechanism of action of heparin. So, what are the uses of heparin? Let's see this in short. Prevention and treatment of thrombotic events, like deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, and atrial fibrillation. To prevent coagulation during cardiac surgery and cardiac percutaneous procedures. For acute coronary syndrome. As a bridge to warfarin therapy. I just wanted to answer this question before concluding the topic, why the coagulation pathways are named intrinsic and extrinsic. It is named intrinsic because, for this pathway, all the required factors are present in the circulation, with no external protein source required. Unlike the extrinsic pathway, where extravascular tissue factor is required for activation of the pathway. This is reason why the pathways are named intrinsic and extrinsic. Thus, we complete the topic here. Hope it was useful. See you soon in the next video.